Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
So my talk is, good afternoon, my talk is going to be from a more application perspective as compared to what Nolan was describing, which is more of a database provenance. But what we have seen is our framework can be applied to even database provenance also. We have mapped our work to that. So to start with, what I'll begin with is use two real-world scenarios of how provenance is actually used in some application domains and kind of motivate our framework and all its components. So this example, this is a very complicated picture. What you can understand from this is we start from a particular sample culture, let's say, and we want to find out what types of different proteins occur in that particular sample. So you go through a lot of steps through that include wet lab experiments, that includes using mass spectrometry instruments and data analysis procedures to finally find out a list of parent proteins and peptide list. But a question that a biologist can ask is, given a peptide list, what is the proteolytic enzyme that was used to actually digest a protein sample? So now you can see tracking all the information from down here all the way back up there is a very complex task when you consider the fact that this is not a completely computational process. It includes manual intervention, it includes wet lab experiments also. So another example from our ongoing research project in parasite research, that a question can be, their work involves creating clone samples or new strains of parasites by knocking out particular genes. So what they try to do is create more virulent strains of a particular parasite or less virulent. But given a clone sample, a researcher might want to know what particular gene was actually knocked out, because that information might be there in a lab notebook or maybe in some database, or maybe just somebody had, you know, just tries to remember that. But if you consider, again, such a complex procedure, what you see here is the clone sample is actually an output of a very complex set of steps, again involving multiple types of processes which are computational, some are computational, some are wet lab. So transfection would be using an instrument, and actually sequence extraction or drug selection might be actually involved manual intervention. So what all these examples show? I'm talking about basically the provenance information which describes the lineage or history of the data entity. And it's derived from the French word provenir. What is provenance used for in real-world applications? In real-world applications, you would need provenance to verify a quality of data. Was a particular experiment process run in the exact correct sequence or not? So you need to validate the processes. And also, you associate trust value, where you can use the provenance information and say that because all this set of parameters were correct, maybe I changed one, I will associate a less confident, confidence value with the final result. Now, in this presentation, what I'm going to talk about is some of the, there are many challenges in provenance management, but specifically I'm going to talk about modeling provenance. With regard to modeling provenance, what I'm going to talk about is we want provenance to be interoperable. So given the previous example in proteomics domain and this example in the parasite domain, we want provenance if I'm getting data from one of these experiments like gene creation, strain creation, another from proteomics information, I want to correlate, I want to compare. So how would provenance be interoperable? And we want to have consistent modeling. If I'm referring to, let's say, transfection as a process here and the transfected sample as an entity, I want the same set of terminologies to be used across projects for data sharing or, as I said, interoperability. And finally, also reduce the terminological heterogeneity. Now, if we consider all these set of issues in provenance modeling, ontologies from as defined in computer science, not philosophical ontologies, and specifically in semantic web, answer a lot or address a lot of these issues. I'll show how. So specifically, I'm talking about provenance ontologies. and how they can help in trying to address some of the issues that I was talking about. So there are great advantages to actually creating ontologies. What you have is you have machine readability because they're defined in a formal language, so softwares can interpret it, and they can interpret it consistently. Then another thing, another great advantage is because associated with these formal description that to create ontologies, you have software called reasoners that can use reasoning to discover implicit knowledge over very large amount of data. So softwares can process through lots of data. But given these advantages, there is a huge problem that we have. So if I'm going to create provenance ontology for parasite research, for proteomics research, for oceanography and all that, what you will end up is with a gigantic monolithic ontology. And this is clearly not feasible. So what we propose is a modular approach. What do I mean by a modular approach? That we can have a basic foundation, what we call a foundational model or an upper level ontology as a reference model. And using that reference model, you can create domain-specific provenance ontologies that address the issues in a particular domain. So you can have parasite experiment ontology, you can have glycoprotein experiment ontology, and one for maybe oceanography also. But because they are being developed by extending the foundational ontology here, they are interoperable. They're interoperable, the data that they're data represented using these ontologies are interoperable, they have consistent interpretation, and also they have modeling consistency. So something that is being defined as an agent in one ontology will also be defined as an agent in another ontology. But so what is this foundational ontology? Now, some of the issues that we need to keep in mind when we are creating a foundational ontology is there should be minimal amount of information. That is what I mean by that is it should not include domain-specific information, because if I include that, and let's say I'm biasing my foundational ontology for parasite research, if somebody in oceanography wants to use it, then they actually have to delete it or change the foundational ontology to incorporate their domain-specific information. And we don't want that. So it's minimal information, it's domain-independent, but it should also be enough for our purposes of modeling provenance. So I'll take the example of the parasite experiment ontology for creating clone samples. What we can clearly, if we remember the procedure, what we can clearly see are there are three basic entities that we have in the whole process. So we have the data itself, the sample, the clone sample. We have an agent, that is the machine that actually did the transfection. And then we have processes, like cell cloning is a process. Now, where do we get these terms from? If you look at the philosophical ontology literature, there are two primitive concepts they talk about. One is called a continuant, and one is called an occurrent. In simple terms, continuant is entities that don't change, and occurrence are entities that are dynamic. Like, for example, process is actually an occurrent. What we did was we took the continuant and created two subclasses. I mean, computer science subclass, very general concept. So we created two subclasses, data and agent. In addition to these concepts, we link them together. Now, one of the core issues in knowledge presentation or data modeling is how things are related to each other. So you can see here that a process is actually linked to agent by a named relation. What we mean by named relation, there's a tag on it, and this tag is also defined formally in the ontology. So software agents can understand how the agent is linked to the process. Similarly, data is actually a participant in a particular process. What means is it's generated from a particular process. Again, you have a tag associated with it. If you take these three basic concepts, now there are different types of data involved with respect to provenance. What we did was we differentiated between two types of data entities in provenance. One we said was what we call as data collection. What it means is if you run a file or you run a particular sample, those are entities that undergo change during a process. And the other set of entities is the parameter. Parameters are instrument settings or the temperature conditions or the things that don't actually undergo change themselves but affect how a particular experiment or a process is happening. Now, if we look at parameter, actually there are multiple types of parameters. We divided them along the classical dimensions of spatiotemporal thematic. What I mean is, for example, spatial would be location of an agent. Or if you take sensor networks, what is the location of a sensor, a particular sensor? We want that information. If we are running a particular process, it's a long-running process, or maybe did an experiment on a particular day, when was this particular process executed? I want that information. So I want temporal information also. So you can see we are not only modeling all the different aspects of provenance information required, you know, to model provenance in these different domains, but we are linking them together using these named relationships. Why I'm concentrating on that is because these named relationships are important from even it has been the importance of named relation has been recognized in semantic web also. I can give you an example why these relationships are important. If you have a person and we have, let's say, a company, a person can be an employee of a company, a person can be a shareholder of a company, or a person can also be a customer of a company. And depending on these different named relations of how a person is linked to a company, their behavior will change. If there is a dividend being announced, you will be announcing it to your shareholders rather than your customers, for example. So that's why these named relationships are very important. So to define these named relationships, so as I said, we took these concepts from the primitive concepts in philosophical ontology. For these relationships, there is a relationship called ontology called relation ontology that defines 11 fundamental relations. We adapted those relations in terms of these concepts that we have defined here. In addition to that, you can also see you can have an ordering of the different processes. So for example, cell cloning occurs before after transfection in the previous example. So you can also order the different processes together. Now this is just a snapshot of the provenance schema. This is how the whole provenance schema looks like. We identify data, agent, process, the has agent property located in, but we also have temporal information about the agent also. So you can ask how long a particular sensor was working correctly. You can also have process information like, for example, data collection happens in, let's say, oceanography. So where is the particular ocean buoy located in? And so you want to link the particular data collection process to the spatial parameter also, location of the ocean buoy. So all this is fine. How is it applicable to the example scenarios that I discussed? So what I'm going to show you, how we took this upper level ontology, Provenir, and try to model domain specific information. So taking the case of the parasite experiment ontology, you can clearly see that transfection machine is a particular type of agent. Samples are a particular type of data collection. Then you have buffer information, basically which are parameters. You have date time information, location, and you also have the different set of processes. Now this is straightforward in extending with respect to parasite experiment ontology. But what Provenir also allows you to do is create more complex information about the particular process. So I can say cell cloning takes in as input a sample. So has participant basically means that particular data set is being used in a particular process. And so on. So you can have transfection buffer is actually a parameter of the transfection process. So you can clearly see that even we have defined this, but to validate its use in a real world scenario, we can actually model all the information that I talked about in the first slides regarding parasite experiments. Let's take another example from the oceanography domain. In this scenario, what we have is an ocean buoy with two types of sensors, an ocean sensor, ocean current measurement sensor, and a temperature sensor. Data collected from these two sensors is sent to a scientific workflow that gives an output as a visualization chart. And we want to find out, given a visualization chart, which particular ocean buoys it came from. Or for example, if a particular ocean buoy is damaged in a storm, we want to discard all the visualization charts that came from particular ocean buoy. So you can trace that information if we are able to model all this provenance information in an ontology. And we did exactly that. So the Trident ontology, this actually is a snapshot of what we call as a class hierarchy. Many people who are working in semantic web already can recognize this, and this is using the Protege toolkit. So what we have here is, I'll specify two concepts here. So we can have information about I don't think it's very visible, but this talks about the authorship of the workflow, or you can talk about different types of tracking information that you have. Now, given that we have kind of some solution for the modeling issues, another important issue is how do we query all this provenance information that we have? So what I'm going to talk about now is we have created an infrastructure using the provenience ontology to actually query this provenance information. So we actually did a systematic classification of all the different types of provenance queries out there. The first example is the one that most is occurs most often. So given a particular gene, find me all the given a clone sample, find me the gene which was used to create it. A very opposite view is what we call as a provenance context-based view. If you look at this example, so find me all the data sets that confirm to these provenance information, that satisfy these provenance constraints. It was created by a particular researcher or between particular dates and using this particular type of material. So what it is actually looking at the opposite view. Traditionally, you would have some data set, some result, and you're trying to find all the provenance information about it. But you can also have the provenance information, but you're looking for the data set that satisfy those provenance constraints. And this is the second type of queries. The third type of queries. So if I have, let's say, a provenance information related to two clone samples, sample ID 65 and 46, how can I compare if they are actually were created under similar conditions? So I want to compare my provenance information. Another can be, how can I merge provenance from two different phases of an experiment? So using this classification, we created what we call as provenance query operators. Now these four query operators exactly map to the classification. So the first one actually is a closure operation, given a data entity, retrieve all my provenance information. The second one is what we call as provenance context, because this provenance constraints that we define on the provenance information is actually a structural context. From the context theory, very well understood, and Ramanathan Guha did a thesis on that. What this provenance context is a particular type of problem-solving context. I define my context, and I'm able to find data sets that satisfy my provenance context. The third and fourth are, of course, you can compare, and you can merge two things. Two sets of provenance. These are actually, for now, we have defined in terms of the RDF graph equivalence and RDF graph merge. But this, you can see that we can generalize it to any kind of graph-based operations if provenance is represented in a generic graph format. We took the provenance query. We actually implemented a query engine for that. I won't go into all the details, but the takeaway points is you can use this provenance query engine as basically an API. On if you require to support those sets of provenance query operators and you have a data store or an application that stores all your provenance information, you put it on top of it, and this will be able to support all the different types of provenance queries that I talked about. What does that specifically mean? You can say, I want to run the provenance query operator. I'll give you the input as the clone sample 65, and all it needs is the user detail information to connect to the particular database. In this case, we have implemented over an Oracle RDF database, but it can be implemented over any database, any RDF database. Some specific points for technical aspects. The provenance queries, by definition, can be very complex. So we have implemented what we call as a materialized provenance views that allows us to optimize complex queries over very large data sets that we have tested with over 308 million RDF triples. And we reduced the query execution time from days to a few minutes. Then we had to implement, this is specific, so Sparkle is the query language for RDF data. We had to implement a particular function for doing transitive closure on the RDF dataset for our query implementation. But the takeaway from this is available as a modular application that you can put on top of your existing data store, and you can start supporting all these different complex provenance queries by just using this API. So that was all the implementation details and the infrastructure. How is it being applied in a real-world scenario? I use the example of the T. cruzi parasite research. What we have here is the complete life cycle of how the data set was being generated, which I talked about initially. So you have a gene knockout where you start a particular experiment for gene knockout or strain creation, where the biological researchers interface through set of web forms. They put in the data, the dates on which they're starting the experiment and the parameter values. So you have this being collected and stored in a RDF data store, but these are being represented using the parasite experiment ontology. Then when they want to query actually their provenance information, we have the provenance query engine on top of this data store that they can use to query that. So we are basically addressing four different aspects of provenance management in this particular project. We are doing provenance capture, we are doing provenance storage, the representation is using the parasite experiment ontology, and we are also supporting provenance query and analysis. So to conclude, what I talked about is introducing the provenir ontology as a foundational model for provenance. I showed how it can actually be extended to model domain specific provenance through two ontologies, the parasite experiment and the Triton. There is a third ontology that we have also created for proteomics scenario that I used in the first slide, but I did not talk about in this presentation, called Proprio. We have a query infrastructure that uses the provenir ontology to support complex provenance queries over different projects. Irrespective of which particular domain you're talking about, we are able to support that using the provenir ontology as the foundational model for representing provenance. And it is being applied right now in our NIH-funded research for parasite research. So to conclude, I'd just like to thank many people. Roger, I worked with last year from where we started this work of creating the provenir ontology. These are our collaborators for the parasite experiment ontology at the Center for Tropical and Emerging Diseases at the University of Georgia. And Flora is at was working also at this center, but she's just moved to the Sanger Institute. Then these are my lab mates at the Noesis Center at Wright State. So some of the references, if you want to.
You'd have two links to the ontology. Mm-hmm. Oh, okay.
Yeah, you can have multiple links, or you can belong to multiple classes, because we are not defining that a spatial parameter cannot be a thematic parameter.
Oh, okay.
Because provenance, from what our experience shows, is very application dependent.
Mm-hmm.
Somebody's provenance, which is generally considered to be a type of metadata, can, in some other application, can be considered as code data.
Yes.
So it's very varied.
So how do you capture provenance? Is it users that have to link?
So some of it is through users. Uh-huh. If you are using computational processes, we are able to do that automatically. So it's a combination of both. So it's not completely automated.
Mm-hmm.
So how do you model an agent that's a machine? Mm-hmm. Say scenario is if you run a lot of data through it, you get a lot of information from it, maybe a year later, you get a report back from the company that manufactured it and said the serial numbers, blah, 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 were defective and created faulty data. Mm-hmm. How do you model that in your system?
So
you have a provenance that was true at the time that you, mm-hmm. you did the experiment.
Right.
But later, it's effectively invalidated.
No. So the provenance is not true. The provenance just captures what happened at a particular time. How you interpret the provenance is different. So then I would say I would actually use the provenance information to invalidate some of the results from that 48 instrument. So here the provenance is never true or false. Provenance is just what happened to them. And how you interpret it is according to application. Carol, you have a question?
No, I was agreeing with you.
So you had a question.
Have you encountered a situation, it seems like an obvious use for this would be to carry the provenance, like say in supplemental materials for a published paper.
Yes, mm-hmm. Yes.
And then you know, again, you have this scenario where you've discovered you've got a problem.
Right.
Have you encountered that, and what have you done?
Yes, so I'm actually right now collaborating with a research scientist at the National Library of Medicine, Olivier Bodenrider, which some of you might know him. His scenario is building something called a biological knowledge repository. And he's extracting data from the PubMed. PubMed has, 14 million abstracts or something like that. So given that some of the journals are not highly ranked, depending on impact factor, you want to associate some confidence values with some of the facts that you're extracting from this. How do you do that? So one aspect of your question will be to actually track the provenance of how, from which particular paper we extracted the information. Another aspect can be the provenance that was reported in the paper itself about the result. Now, that can be addressed to only a partial extent because we don't have access to what the actual authors did. We can only get the information from what the paper has. Mm-hmm. But that we have not looked at right now. But that's something, very interesting. Yes. Yeah.
I'll ask the typical question. We have the open provenance model that's out there, which essentially is the core of this model here. So it seems like, you know, the two differences I can spot off the bat is you've tried to connect the data ontology to break that up a little bit on top of here, and you don't have the notion of accounts,
okay,
which is basically the framework for deciding when one person says I went through the resume and then the other part came in and vice versa, you know, to be able to separate those out. So.
Could you again find the sense of accounts?
So, accounts are basically the graph that one person claimed, right? So think of a court of law.
So if
I went into the intersection, then the light turned versus the other way around.
Transfer it to the notion of in the RDF environment, you'd be named graphs. Right? So you have associating a name particular.
You can implement them as named graphs, but that's just the character, that's just a mechanism.
Right. But the idea is that you need an account mechanism to be able to talk about.
So account is not only of that particular type, you can also have accounts with respect to a particular project. So for a particular project, what are all the data sets that I generated? Now that's also an account, that's a project account, right? You can also have institution-based account. Why just a person account? You can have different types of accounts.
That's not the sense in OPM of account.
No, I know. But I'm saying, you can have multiple types of accounts. And here, accounts is not explicitly modeled. Account is inferred. So if I take the provenance context as a structure, it's a formal structure, that's an account. If I'm defining that a particular researcher did all these experiments, that information about related to a specific researcher becomes an account.
The idea of accounts in OPM is that, in some sense, causality has to be correct within an account. And you can have people who disagree about which name first and outside of accounts. So
it's a
really
view
important.
Of what is happening.
Mm-hmm. So you can make assertions on the basic provenance itself. You can have provenance information and somebody make an assertion that I don't believe this is actually correct. And this is supported in here.
Why can't you adopt OPM for the basics of this stuff?
Some of the basic issues is, these three entities, data, agent, and process, actually, very coincidentally, and actually Yogesh presented some of, in his talk last year, the feedback at OPM, is we developed these concepts from an existing ontology that we released in 2005, 2006, called Proprio. What the ontology model was a provenance about proteomics domain. We took some of the abstract level concepts from there, and we identified these three. And by the time we actually released, and I was reviewing the OPM, I found coincidentally they were the exact same. And which is a very good thing. I mean, no denying, and basically validates both modeling perspectives. But where it differs from, or where this problem in ontology differs from OPM, is the use of these named relationships. OPM considers only causality relationships. It does not, for example, how can I model the location of an agent? Isn't that important provenance information? How do I model that in OPM?
Isn't that important metadata for non-provenance applications too?
So exactly, so I did not say.
Why should it be in a foundational provenance ontology as opposed to that you compose at that level too?
No. So the point is it important with respect to a particular application? It is important provenance information. For example, in the sensor domain, or in oceanography domain, the location of ocean buoys or sensors is very important. And it's important provenance information. And OPM cannot model that.
Well, so is a researcher's name.
Exactly.
But that's already defined in FOV, so we don't put it in a provenance ontology.
True. This is interoperable with FOV. There's no reason why FOV is not interoperable with this.
Yes,
so the point here is not...
But
so
you decided not to put FOV in here, but you decided...
You can extend this with FOV. So, for example, I can extend the agent.
And I can add in the data stuff and the spatial thematic temporal stuff as well. So the question is why... Why is the natural home of those things in a provenance ontology as opposed to a separate ontology that you compose to do provenance queries?
So
the same way you decided not to put FOV inside.
So why this, what's talking to this lady, provenance is very application specific. You cannot clearly delineate provenance and provenance as a metadata and data. Information about a particular agent can be also part of the data in an experiment. But it can be considered as provenance metadata in another application. So we are not saying that there is a clear demarcation between all this provenance and all this data, and you cannot mix them too. What we have done here is, if you see, data is actually one of the elements of this whole provenance ontology. Depending on your use case, you define this as provenance information, or you define this as your data. So it depends on you. So this is a lot more flexible. There are no concrete barriers separating what I consider to be provenance and what I consider to be data. It depends on the application. So that's the flexibility aspect of what we affect model.
But there isn't an OPM either, so I think it would be very good, I think, to have you guys in the discussion, because there's a lot of, right, there's been several challenges that lay out the queries. There's a lot of discussion about how you can model this stuff and where the bad corner case is. So that certainly is something that I would encourage you to keep connected.
Definitely. I mean, that's what I basically was. So during my internship, Yogesh went to Chicago, I think Salt Lake City, along with Roger, to discuss their feedback on OPM. I contributed some of my issues that I had with OPM in that presentation. And one of the main issues that I spoke and I have repeatedly spoken after that is the issue of these name relationships. Causality is not the only provenance information that one should be tracking. Provenance information includes many other types of relationships. And it's important to consider that also. And you should not rigidly say that I'm going to say a process was caused by a particular agent. You can also have information about the where agent, for example, researcher, where the researcher is working in what institution the researcher is working at. And that can be provenance information. So that's what I think can be enriched by our interaction. I think Provenir, along with the OPM, we can interact and basically these are some of the changes I would have liked to see in OPM, and that's what I have been trying to interact through Yogesh last year and trying to get across those points.
So maybe last question. A follow-on to that is there's a new provenance incubator group at the WPC that this kind of discussion I think belongs in. So we're submitting the proof markup language, which was also a province in the linear world that was developed 5 years ago and has been evolving. There's a number of them. And I think actually what's coming out in this group is provinces time has come. Plus, there is another round of IPAW that's going to happen in June of 2010 at RPI, and another round of province challenge that we'll have to co-locate with them. So everybody who was participating should consider.
So I'll add to what Deborah was saying. We also have a semantic provenance workshop at the International Semantic Web Conference. And Carol is giving the keynote, and everybody, it would be great if everybody comes. And so we also have database perspectives. So Susan Davidson is giving an invited talk. And then we have from, I think, RPI, a couple of papers there, and also from Migrant. And so it will be a very good thing. So everybody's invited. Thank you.
Thank you, Sanjay.